H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Okay, it's not yet opening. So let's take an example here. Okay, so I am having two tables. The first one is customer table and the second one is order table. And for example, I am having an requirement like get all the customers for each of the, get all the orders for each of the customer on a particular bill round date. So for that particular date, for each of the customer, I want the orders. How many orders he had done for that particular day. So that's what my requirement. If that is the case, definitely I have to join these two tables. And based on the employee ID, I can join. See, if you see the first table customer, there I am having customer ID, the name and his particular number. And if you take the orders table, I am having customer ID, order ID, time at which he has ordered and date at which he has purchased that particular order. Right? So, where is my mouse? Okay. So, for each of the map function, each particular group key will be given as an input. So the tag is nothing but the table name here. Okay, let me finish this and I will show you. Okay, the tag is nothing but the table name. So for each of the record you are giving a tag. So if you take the first record 1, comma Stephen Leung and the number, he has given a tag with the table name itself. And again, if you see here, for each of the record, so suppose for the first record 3, comma A, comma time and date, for that particular record he has given a tag as orders. So for each record, the table name itself will be given as the tag name. And this tag and the record will be grouped together and given as a key. So for each of the line in my table, I will be given with a key which holds both the tag and the actual record. So my output of my map will look like key comma record. In general, the output will look like key comma value, right? But here the output will be in the form of key comma record. Means it will be like key is my 3 and my record is, so maybe key, I will take the first record, okay? So key comma value means the whole record, Stephen Leung 555 comma 333333 or something like that. Whatever I have the data in my record, it will be in that form. So key comma record will be my output of my mapper, and the same will be my input to my reducer. Okay, so key is customer ID which is used to join the records from the customer file to order file, and my record is entire record wrapped by a tag called as customer. Right? So for my customer table, I am giving a tag called as customer, and the whole tag will be my input as a record here. And again, if you see, once my map functions are finished, the shuffle and sort will come into picture, and based on the group key, all this shuffling and sorting will happen. So if you take the group key 1 as example, in group key 1 I have customers tag as well as orders tag. So in my right side table I am having a group key 1, and on my left side table I am having a group key 1. So based on the group key, these two will be clubbed together and it will generate the output as in this way. So for one group key I am having customers and orders, and again for if you take the second one, here I am having a customer line and here I am having a order line. So both will come together as a single group key, and this will be sent as an input to my reduce function. And but if you observe again, here 3 is having 3 values. So in customer table I am having 1 record, and in order table I am having 2 records. If you see the first line and also the fourth line of my order table, I am having same key. So all these same group keys will come into together as a picture as given here. So for group key 3, I am having customers line, orders record, and again orders record. And in this way, all will be the cross product on these values will happen, and it creates all these combinations once it sends to reducer function. So what happens internally is, for if you take the consider, or if you take the record 3 or group key 3, what my reduce function will do is, it will distribute or it will create all the combinations that were available for each of the tag. So the probable combinations that can happen here is customers comma order first record, customers comma order second record, right? If this is not the case, if you imagine like I have 2 customer records and 3 order records, total number of outputs I would get from my reducer is 6, which is just a combination of 2 into 3. So totally I can get 6 types of combinations, and each will be an output to my reducer. And once it is done, there will be a function called as combine. This combine function is not similar to my combiner. Combiner has a different functionality, and this combine function has completely different functionality. This combine function will just club the records whatever that were available for each of the key. So if you take the first one, the customers and orders, here it will club all the records based on the key. So it will get the 3 and the name, and now the customer order number, and again the time and his date of purchase. So it will just club or combine all the record values that were available for each of the key. So that's what my combine functionality does here. And again, the joins will happen in different ways. As we all know, there might be different forms of join, right? There may be inner join or left outer join or right outer join, etc., etc., right? And if you take the inner join, it is like it should see all the tags that were available. So if you take the first the previous slide, the fourth group key is having only one single tag out of 2 tags that were available, right? So if you apply inner join here, it will drop this particular record, because first of all, once the combine function will come into picture, it will see like whether it has all the tags that were available at the time of my submission of job. And it sees like, okay, only customer tab is available, but there is no order tag. So don't consider this particular value, and thus it will drop this fourth group key whenever I perform a inner join. So that's how it happens differently for each of the join. Okay. God, what happened? It's very, very slow. Okay, let it be for some time. Okay, so that is how joins happens in MapReduce. So shall I go to the next topic? Which is inverted index. As the name indicates, the keys and values, whatever we had talked, will be in inverted way. So the mapper function will be like, for each word in a line, emit word comma file name. Suppose there are four files that I had given as input in my mapper file. So the outputs from my mapper will be in the form of word comma file name. So in the sense, I have, for example, four files A, B, C, D. Okay, my outputs from my mapper will be like hi comma A, hi comma A, hi comma A. So it will be like hi word have been, sorry, B and C. So my hi word is repeated in all the three files, first file, second file and third file. So the output of my mapper will be like word comma file name, hi comma file name, which is A, B and C. And reducer is, most of the times I will be using the default reducer here, which is identity reducer, which will collect all these values together and it will emit these words like word comma file name list. So my reducer will emit the key values as hi comma A comma B comma C as my key value pair. So output of my reducer will be like this. So these kind of inverted indexes will be applied if there are multiple number of files that needs to be processed and I want to know like what kind of information I have in each of the file. So if the user is much more concentrating on the data on each of the file, at that case we will apply inverted index. So this is a sample example of the data flow which shows you how the processing will happen. So if you take the first record of your first map file, which is A file, the output will be in the form of key comma value, which is each word comma file name. So my map A output will be in the form of this comma A, page comma A, contains comma A, so comma A, much comma A and text comma A. And the same way, the output of my map function, which is for B, will be like my comma B, page comma B, contains comma B, text comma B and 2 comma B. So it's like word comma file name and all these will be clubbed together. In the sense, the functionality of my reducer is not changing here, just the emitting of the key value pairs is in different form, but the functionality is same. That's the reason we are having again in my reducer as key comma values. Again, like contains comma file names, whatever that were available or wherever this word is found. So contains comma A comma B, because this contains word is available both in file A and file B. So that's the reason it is throwing as contains comma A comma B. The same way, much comma A, my comma B, page comma A comma B, so comma A and so on. So that is what inverted index is about. Okay, so few other concepts as well. sometimes we will be in need of only one of the job that was in the whole map functionality job. So it's like sometimes I need only map functions. So let's take a case like I need to convert a particular image, or maybe I want to convert a PDF file to a Word file. At that case, there is no reduce function actually needed, right? So it's like a just conversion requirement I'm having. So in one form to another form, I'm going to convert it. At those kind of situations, I don't need a reduce function. So it's just like converting to some GIF file or something, converting into another format. Earlier also we used to have this functionality. I mean, in other ecosystems or maybe out of Hadoop box also we have these functionalities. But what here we are achieving is we are able to apply this functionality parallelly. That's it. So it doesn't follow the exact MapReduce format or exact MapReduce framework. It's just only one of the particular task is going to be reduced. So the number of my map outputs will be my final outputs itself, right? Because there is no reducer function here. So number of input splits is equal to number of outputs. So 100 mappers means 100 output files. So these are the few cases where I will write only map only jobs. So image conversions or file format conversions or maybe some ETL operations. So at those cases I will write only map functions. And at those kind of places my number of reducers will be zero, right? So at that point I have to declare that value in my driver code as job.set number of reduced tasks as 0, and anything that is written output, I mean anything that output that was generated by mapper, it will be written to HDFS itself, because it's not the intermediate data, right? So definitely it has to directly go to HDFS. It's like the final output which we are generating from mapper job itself. So one file from each of the mapper or one output from each of the mapper is written directly to HDFS. And the last topic here we are going to discuss is failures in Hadoop. Hadoop is definitely a very rigorous system and it is going to handle huge amount of data, right? At any point of time there may be failures, because here we are using commodity hardware and there are definitely chances of failure most of the times. So basically if you distribute all these failures, there are majorly three kinds of failures in our Hadoop cluster. The first one is task failure, and the second one is task tracker failure, and the last one is job failure. So let's take the first case of task failure. The general scenario where we will see the task failure is the case of child task failing. So in the sense there might be some exception error that was created in my MapReduce job. At that point of time my particular task is going to be failed, right? So if you read the slide, this might happen when the user code in the map or reduce task throws a runtime exception. In this case, the child JVM reports the error back to its parent task tracker. So whenever the child JVM goes down or whenever this particular exception is found, my particular child JVM will go and say to the task tracker as I am not able to work and it will not be able to send a heartbeat. Now task tracker will mark it as failed and it will free that particular slot for another task to get scheduled. And another form of task failure is some bug in my JVM itself. So there is some error in my execution of JVM and that's the reason it was failed. So it's like just exit of my JVM abruptly. So at that moment task tracker notices that process have been exited and again it marks that particular task as failed and it will try to schedule the job as well. So, which is the second case? Sudden exit of child JVM. Maybe because of JVM is big, which is causing this exit. Or maybe that particular job is very big and it is not able to finish in that particular scheduled time. At that moment, the task tracker will have a note of it and it will schedule it again. And the next one is hanging tasks. The task tracker notices that it hasn't received a progress update for a particular amount of time. So it will try to see for 10 minutes or something like that, and it will check whether it is able to receive heartbeat from that particular task. If it's not able to receive, means it will note it as that particular job is failed. And it will kill that particular job automatically. So the default value that is going to be weighted is 10 minutes of time. So each task tracker will wait for 10 minutes to get the heartbeat from each of the tasks. Within that particular remit, if that is not able to get the heartbeat, the task tracker will automatically kill that task. Again, this 10 minutes concept is configurable. Whatever the admin likes or whatever the admin wishes, he can give that or he can declare it. He can give for 5 minutes or 2 minutes as well. So the task tracker will wait until that time is finished, and if it's not able to receive the heartbeat, it will abruptly kill that job. And again, once it is killed, it will reschedule it again on a different task tracker. So it will see like, okay, this particular task tracker is not able to handle this, maybe we will try to submit the same job on a different task tracker. So it will try to reschedule it on a different task tracker whenever it got failed, and the maximum attempts it will try is only 4. So it will try to execute on 4 different task trackers, and if this particular task goes down on each of these task trackers, it will just kill this job and it will not reschedule it again also. So that's what the different cases when considering the task failures. And the next one is task tracker failure. So if a task tracker fails by crashing or running very slowly, it will stop sending heartbeats to job tracker. So if you observe the precedence or if you observe the flow of these heartbeats, each child task will send a heartbeat to the task tracker, and every time the task tracker will send a heartbeat to job tracker, right? So now the case is with task tracker failure. So whenever it is failed, it will be removed from the pool and the job tracker will arrange to rerun the map jobs. So suppose my particular job, whatever I had submitted, has 100 tasks, okay? And now at 50th job is finished, my task tracker went down. What my job tracker does is, it will try to reschedule all these 100 jobs again. It won't start from 51st map task. It will start from the first map task again, because this intermediate data might get corrupted somewhere internally because of this task tracker failure, and my reducer will not be able to get the proper data. So that's the reason it will start whatever the tasks that were in progress again from the beginning. And also there is a case like a task tracker can also be blacklisted by the job tracker if the number of tasks that have failed on it is significantly higher than the average task failure rate on that cluster. So it will see like every time it will monitor my task tracker and it will see like, okay, this particular task tracker has executed 10,000 tasks till now, and I see that in most of the cases the particular task is going to be failed. So for example, 8,000 tasks have been failed till now out of my 10,000 jobs. It will see like, okay, this task tracker is not working properly. Let me keep this task tracker in a blacklist such that any of my further upcoming jobs will not be given to this particular task tracker. So monitoring will happen at the back end. And the last kind of failure is job tracker failure. So this scenario is very rare scenario, because the machine that we are going to be used in my job tracker, for my job tracker, will be a very good sophisticated machine, and the cases of my job tracker failure will be very, very low. If at all my job tracker is failed, it needs to be considered as a very serious failure. Till now, whatever the failures we had seen is like the common failures which will happen in general, and the admin doesn't need to concentrate much more on it, and he can just schedule it on another task trackers that were available. But if the case the job tracker goes down, he has to take utmost care, and he has to see like what is the reason for that failure. So the failure of this kind is very low chance of occurring, since that machine failing is very low, and as of now there is no mechanism to deal with this kind of failure. But right now, whatever the current versions we are having right presently, we don't have any particular mechanism to overcome this job track failure. Maybe in our further releases we will get it, but as of now the current stable Hadoop version is not having any mechanism to deal with this kind of failure. So that's what pretty much about the failures in Hadoop as well. So totally in a high level, we have three kinds of failures, and each has its own way to overcome these kinds of failure, except for the job tracker failure. So let me see my VM how it is. Why it's being in a small way? So okay, if you see into the Hadoop 1.0.3 version, you should be able to see this country folder. Is everyone able to see this folder? So whenever you install Hadoop by default, this folder will get created, and in this contribute folder I will be having a data join folder. So this data join folder will contain the actual jar file that needs to be included whenever I am writing a joins program in MapReduce. So this jar file needs to be included in my MapReduce program. So whenever I am writing programs, I use it to include all the libraries, right? So maybe some partitioner. So here I am having all the referenced libraries, right? If I make it big again, it will be... Oh God, now it came. What happened? Okay guys, it's not working, but hopefully I think you understood it. It was closed abruptly, but just let me know if you're not able to understand how to add that particular jar. You are able to see the jar, right? In the data contrib folder, I will have data join folder. In it, I will have the jar file which needs to be included in your MapReduce program. That's it. That is the only thing I wanted to show you. So any questions on this, guys? So by this we are going to end the MapReduce program, and from tomorrow onwards we are going to start the next ecosystem, which is called as Pig. Okay, just let me know in case if you have any questions. Yes, Prabita. Tell me, Prakita. That's not an issue, Pravita. I think the recording for this installation have been already shared. You can just go through that, and even I have shared the document to install Hadoop on your VM. You can just follow that and you can try installing it by yourself. Okay, I will try to ask the organizer as well. Yeah, sure. I will try to organize it as well to share those recordings with you so that you can try doing it also. Okay? Sure, yeah. So, any other question, guys? All good with MapReduce? Thank you, Prabita. Hopefully you should be able to write a simple MapReduce program by this time. No worries, Prabita. Yeah, sure, Rahul. I will be sharing all the programs. I mean, apart from the programs, whatever I had explained, I will try to give you some other programs as well, such that you will try to, you can practice it into your home, and you can try yourself understanding those programs, because it's not the case like I go and explain each of the programs manually, right? So you should be able to understand some programs by use as well. So that's the reason I had not shown you all the programs. So the basic programs I had shown you, and you can experiment yourself writing or changing the requirements. So for example, I had given you the word count. You can write a program for yourself stating that, okay, give me the outputs where each of the word has been repeated 4 times. Or something like that. So you can create the programs for yourself and try writing them as well. And also definitely come back to me if you have any questions whenever you are trying those kind of programs, okay? But definitely I will share you few other programs also, and not only the programs whatever I had explained to you. So whenever you are trying to do some dummy projects later on part of time, it will be very helpful for you also. Just at least for reference purpose also, it will be useful. Sure, welcome. So any other questions, guys, before I wrap up for today? So hopefully I think everyone is a bit comfortable with MapReduce by today. At least the basic concepts you should be able to understand, or you should be able to answer. I don't say that you should be able to understand. At this point of time, you should be able to answer. That's what my expectation is. Okay? Fine. Okay. Thank you guys for joining. We will meet at the same time tomorrow evening. Okay. Have a good night.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.